And you say you're going to do these waivers on a case-by-case basis, so I guess you've got a criteria set for how they get a waiver or not?
I think that would be more of a question for DHS in the process of how those waivers are administered.
So is there a criteria?
There's a system that by February 23rd that will have all of these additional questions. For instance, if you were doing a legitimate business in Iran, you would have to, of course, had an Iranian business passport with those numbers. So there'll be a whole
What part of the law, I guess, talked about business purposes having a waiver?
So the protocol would be that there, if you were claiming that you wished under, and by the way, no waiver has been granted and no waiver.
Right, but it's a national security or law enforcement waiver. It was fairly clear, wasn't it? National security or law enforcement waiver. Isn't that right, Ms. Johnson?
It is correct.
Okay. So how can you quantify that a business purpose is a national security purpose?
So I think there are.
I'm a business guy, and I mean, so that means I'm a national security risk.
Or a national security benefit.
Because what I'm hearing, and let me tell you what troubles me, it sounds like we've created a jobs program for Iran, that we're concerned about their business activity at the expense of the national security of all freedom-loving Americans. Have we done that? Because that's what Mr. Heifetz indicated. It's important for their economy. So is that what we've done, Ms. Johnson? We've created a jobs program?
No, sir. This
then why do we give an exception according to DHS? I guess the exception is for legitimate business purposes, and it's not just in Iran. It's in Iraq, and they're not part of the agreement in terms of the JCPOA. So why would we include Iraq and Syria and Sudan if it's not trying to help them get investors from Europe?
Well, under the business, it's only Iraq and Iran, and we certainly want to see Iraq's economy do...
So it is a jobs program.
Well, we certainly want to see Iraq's economy do better so that they can support their own defense and...
But I can tell you, that was nowhere in the deliberations between the minority or the majority. When we were talking about this, it had nothing to do with business purposes, so how does the administration start to interpret this law as somehow being a jobs program? Ms. Johnson?
Again, it's not a jobs program. It's not about it's not about Iran. It's about our national security. And I work in the Counterterrorism Bureau at the State Department, and so I'm very focused on the fact that the protection of the homeland, which the entire State Department is focused on, is one of our major priorities.
So wouldn't allowing more business travelers who travel from Belgium or France going to Iran potentially create a greater national security threat than if they never traveled there at all? I'm not talking about the visa waiver program because I know you've been defaulting that. Could it not potentially create a greater national security threat?
I don't see the connection in the sense that these are under the JCPOA. These countries can't.
One of them is. Not all those countries are under that. Am I confused? Or are they all under that? I thought only a few of those were. Like one.
The program, the VWP partnership, again, for us with our partners under the VWP program, they
That's
can
different.
Go.
That's different than what you just said, though. I understand. So if the VWP program is all great, why don't we expand it to all the countries if it actually increases our national security? Why don't we increase it to Israel?
I would think that, you know, there again,
aren't they
other
ally?
Countries that want
They're
to
a closer ally than Iran, aren't they?
Well, there's requirements to get into the program, a number of factors.
But Iran hasn't met those requirements, have they?
It's invisible. But they're not about Iran.
But they're enjoying the benefit. Let me go on. I got a few minutes left. For DHS, the report that you sent only had 2 of 70 types of visas. Is there any reason why we excluded the other 68 types on that report?
We were given this mission, the entry-exit mission, by Congress in 2013.
No. There's a GAO report. You were given the mission back in the 1990s.
I'm sorry. I'm speaking as the Commissioner of Customs and Border.
Okay. Your agency.
Right. We were given that mission in 2013. And as you know, there had not been a visa waiver overstay report for many, many, many years.
1994.
Right, until last year. It was very clear that there was a lot.
Well, there hasn't still been one. Let's be clear about that. We've had a partial report.
I'll agree that certainly a partial report. It is certainly a step ahead and a step better than what had ever been issued before under many administrations.
Well, that's true, because it hadn't been issued in 20 years. So, I mean, something is always better than nothing. I guess when are we going to get the full report?
So the full report and the number of things, and we'd be happy to spend some time with you or your staff briefing you about all the things that DHS and Customs and Border Protection is doing to try to increase the quality of the data. You know that an overstay, if you leave the country one day after your visa expired, you're considered an overstay even though you have left the country.
Yeah, but that's not the numbers we're talking about. Let's don't give a false premise here, and if the chair will indulge this last clarifying question. We have reason to believe that the number of overstays, if you include all the categories, is closer to 750,000 versus the 500,000 that has been indicated. Would you agree with that, that estimate? Have you seen any estimate?
I don't know. I have not.
All right. Now yield back.
Chairman.